So go ahead and stand to your feet. Hopefully you've been following on social media. You're getting our weekly updates. We had an awesome time at the EXO Marriage Conference this last Friday and Saturday night. Last weekend, Super Bowl. We have life groups coming up and other opportunities for you to connect. We are a community. We belong. We need one another. And so with that, schedule us in. Schedule us in and reach out to those that you don't see here as well. So let's go ahead and just ready our hearts. God, we honor you. We lift up praise and adoration. We exalt you, King Jesus, King of glory. There is no one like you, Lord. There is no one like you, Lord. You're strong and mighty. Oh, we lift praise and we ask that you settle upon us, God. Let your presence, let your glory fall.
Come on, put your hands together in this house. Sing this with me. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'll praise in the valley. I'll praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure. I'll praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when I'm numbered. I'll praise when surrounded. Cause praise is the waters my enemies drown in. Come on. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise. I'll praise cause I know you're still in control. My praise is a weapon, it's more than a sound. My praise is the shout that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise. Oh my soul,
come on and pray.
Praise the Lord. Oh my soul,
I won't be quiet.
No, I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? Praise the Lord. Oh my soul,
praise the Lord. Come on, let me see those hands. You are worthy of all our praise today.
I'll praise. I'll praise cause you're sovereign. Praise cause you reign. Praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. Praise cause you're faithful. Praise cause you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise cause you're sovereign. Praise cause you reign. Praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. Praise cause you're faithful, praise cause you're true, praise cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Come on, come on.
Yes. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
You don't wanna pray.
Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
just lift up praise. Go ahead. Sing it out. Sing it out.
Come on, is anybody glad to serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? The one that will never fail you, that will never abandon you, that looks down and says, that is my son and daughter for whom I am well pleased, who I will love through every season. Amen.
Lord, aren't you glad that he reigns above it all? And when we praise, it puts him in that proper perspective. So God, we ask that you just come and rule and reign over every heart and mind. The reign of darkness now has ended in the kingdom of light. In the kingdom of light, forever under your dominion. You're the King of my life. You're the King of my life. You reign above it all. You reign above it all. Over the universe and over. There is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. And on the cross, the work was finished. God, you poured out your life just to give us new life. Now from the lips of the forgiven, hear an anthem. with power and love. Our God is an awesome God. You reign above it all. You reign above it all. Over the universe and over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. Let all of heaven and the earth erupt in song. Sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. Come on, in your own way, just tell him, God, you reign above. Above what I'm going through, above what I see all around me, God, you reign in my family, in my heart, in my mind. Oh, you reign above evil and darkness and hate. Oh, you reign.
Today we want to praise you, Lord, because you deserve it. Lord, because our hearts long for more and more of you. Sing this with me. A thousand generations
falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing a song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. Above all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cry, holy, you were lifted high.
People sing, holy, to the King.
is the greatest. Your name, it stands above them all, above all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name, it stands above them all. Oh, your name, your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all, above all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry.
Every thought that doesn't come in alignment, Lord, we lay it at your feet. We say, take control in this place. Lord, take control in this place. Come on, people of God.
Holy forever.
Take it all. 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 Have it all. Take it all. Take it all. Take it all.
Got a new song I want to introduce you to today, and it's called Trust in God. And sounds easy to say just right there, trust in God, like, oh, of course. And we're going to get together, we're going to sing the chorus, I trust in God. It's beautiful, right? And then you go to do it, and it's a lot more difficult. Yeah. One of the hardest things that you'll do, really, in your life, trusting God, trusting other people. And especially now where a lot of things are just, I really don't know if that's real or not. I don't know if that's Photoshop. I don't know if that's AI. I don't know if, right?
Come on.
It's confusing out here. I don't know if that person really looks like that, or that's just makeup on their Instagram profile. Like, then you go on a date and you're like, whoa. Praise God.
We need some real life.
Created, but she's not for me. We don't know. We don't know what's real, but let me tell you something today. God is.
Yes.
And what happened on the cross is very real.
Yes.
Can we get some praise for that?
Yes, he's real.
Let me tell you something. When you go full send, after the cross, after Jesus, that's never gonna let you down.
That's right.
Whatever you're holding on to right now that you think is propping up your life, your very identity, the choices that you make every day, let it go and surrender to Jesus and see what will happen. I guarantee, you heard me, guarantee your life will change. You will see transformation. Whether you think it's happening or not, sometimes you need to ask the people around you, hey man, how much are these days? And they'll be like, dude, I've seen. So today, we're going to trust in God. Amen?
Amen.
blessed assurance.
Come on.
Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. And what He did for me on Calvary is more than enough. Oh, I trust in God, my Savior.
trust you, Lord.
My Savior, the one.
You're the one and only.
Who will never fail. He will never fail.
For who you are and what you're doing. And if you just turn to three people and just tell them, I serve an unfailing God. Come on, tell them with a smile on your face. Of righteousness come forth. There are people who still need to know Jesus. How many have friends, family members that still need to know Jesus? Come on. How many have neighbors that need to know Jesus, right? How many someone cut you off today and they need to know Jesus? All right. There's people in our life that are missing from God. And it is our job. It is our job to plant the seed of righteousness in their life. No. Let me just say this. It is our privilege to plant the seed of the gospel in their heart. Come on.
Amen.
Do you have any partners in that? So we're continuing our Kingdom Builders Month. And today we have Will and Jen with us from DCF, Davis Christian Fellowship, which is a ministry called Chi Alpha. And it's a ministry. They have two houses on the UC Davis campus. And they're a wonderful couple that is doing amazing things in the life of young adults who are educating themselves to be doctors, CPAs, engineers. But Jesus is getting a hold of their life. And how many knows an encounter with God changes everything? Come on. We believe that around here that We're here to encounter the presence of Jesus, His Holy Spirit in our life. And so I'm so excited to have them today. And before He comes, we're going to watch this video about what God is doing at DCF.
An estimated 2,000 students have been involved here with this ministry over these past three decades plus. Not only that, we've had 500 students go on spring and summer short-term missions trips, and 70 of our alumni have given a year or more on the mission field, both locally and abroad. In the midst of this amazing history, we believe we're living in one of the most powerful moments yet for the Davis Christian Fellowship story. And really, you've been a part of it, friends. This past year, I've kind of looked at this year as an outpouring. We have seen in California, you may know, in the natural, a record rainfall like never before. We literally, during September, welcome week last year, it was raining. I've never seen that happen in my 25 years here at Davis before. And that kind of pattern continued throughout the academic year. In the winter, we had the Asbury College outpouring in Kentucky. And my wife and I, we got to go out there and see what God was doing. It was miraculous, with lives being transformed, students surrendering all to Jesus. And then we had the 1970 Jesus Movement story in the Jesus Revolution film that was released as well, that really inspired today's student to believe for the generation. And friends, I'm here to report that God's doing it at UC Davis, with 150 students gathering weekly for worship in a lecture hall, 29 of our students leading Bible studies all throughout the week, and really, life's being changed here on these properties right across the street from campus. So many of you have been a part of our story with these properties right by campus, seeing the transformation from the little shack built in 1906 that was transformed in 1999 to the DCF House, to in 2016 launching the Glory House campaign, a live-in residence, a discipleship community, and expanding our footprint literally 10 yards from the busiest corner of campus. And really, I'm happy to report today that in the midst of this outpouring, with this spring, we had 31 students say they've committed their life or recommitted their life to Jesus, that in the midst of all what God's doing, that we've seen an outpouring through your generosity with the resources to see a dream fulfilled. That's right, here in the seventh year of the Glory House, number of completion, we are fully funded. The Glory House is paid off. And I just want to make this video and say thank you for being a part of the story here at UC Davis. You see, with this outpouring, I believe God has put a call in Jennifer and I's hearts that we would be a sending place, that Davis is called to be a sending place to other campuses, that we could raise up campus missionaries to help plant a ministry specifically in SoCal. And we've had interns, campus missionaries in training, commit a year after graduation to raise support and to be trained to become a missionary. This year we have three more joining our team, and we're believing that in this coming year that we're gonna send out a team to plant ministry in SoCal. And I'm asking you in this video, as we're seeing one dream fulfilled, to continue to dream with us, to believe that God is doing a truly an outpouring, raising up a generation that will live fully for Him and believe not just for our own campus, but for campuses across the state and into the nations. And just like Scripture says, let there be light, and it's the motto of UC Davis, we're believing that the light of Jesus is going to shine, and we are going to continue to go glory from glory. Thank you for being a part of this. We love you. God bless.
Come on. God, we give you thanks for those lives that have come to Jesus. And some of you may be sitting there and say, well, how do I get a part of that? I'm glad you asked. You step into the yes. That's what we believe at Real Life Church, is we are a yes church. When Jesus calls us, we say it with me, yes. We don't say, I don't know if I feel led. If they're hungry, they're hurting, they need reconciliation, we say, yes, Lord. Here we are. We're here to serve. We're here to pour into and pour out of what God's put in our life. And so we're going to give you an opportunity next week. So look around the room, look at your neighbor and say, be here next week, because there's an opportunity for you to invest in this. And let me tell you, it's the most fulfilling investment that you can make. Because you know that someday, when we stand worshiping Jesus, there's going to be people that we invested in. They're going to be worship the Lamb of God, laying their golden crowns at the throne, saying, "Worthy are you, God. Worthy are you, God." And we don't even see them and know them right now, but let me tell you, they exist because of your generosity. So today, would you welcome to this stage and to Real Life Church, Will Clear.
Thank you so much. Praise God. Oh, this is so great to be with you guys. Good morning, church. Man, let me see if I can get a little, get this. Can you help me with this in a second here? Just kind of angle here. I got some notes for us so I stay on track. I have one of those brains where I could just go a lot of bunny trails, so notes help me make sure we have lunch today and all that. But we are seeing an outpouring at UC Davis, and we're so thankful for this church because you've been partners with us in ministry as your kingdom builders to be there, to be people on the ground, to welcome students, to love students, and to point them to Jesus. And yeah, and this year, like that video said, it's been a year like no other. And I just want to just first off by saying thank you guys. Thanks for being a part of this and just to be a part of seeing lives transformed. Thank you so much. That looks great. Appreciate it. But yeah, so I mentioned at the end of that video, we are planning to send a team from UC Davis to SoCal. We're still discerning which campus, but I believe I was here last year and shared that God's put a burden in our hearts to take what God's done at UC Davis to campuses across the state, and specifically in Southern California, where Chi Alpha, our national ministry out of the Assemblies of God, we're on 300 campuses nationwide, but from Fresno to San Diego, we have a very small footprint. We have a student-led group at UCLA, and we do an international ministry at UC Santa Barbara, which is wonderful. But there's over 156 colleges and universities from in that region, and we have a lot of work to do. And we just really believe that God has trusted us with so much that we want to be a part of what he's doing in Southern California through Chi Alpha. So be praying with us. We're taking a big step this March. We're using our UC Davis spring break. And we have a team of 22 that we're going to go and prayer walk campuses. We're going to go to 10 different campuses in 8 days and just really discern what God's doing on these campuses and believe that he's going to raise up a ministry to reach those students with the hope of Jesus. And we're also sending a team to Mexico as well during spring break. So please pray for us. It's a strategic time. And during that time, God really does something in the hearts of students where they get his heart for the nations and the heart for other people. And like we said in the video, we've had students go all over the world with their degrees, not only in the marketplace, but as missionaries for the gospel of Jesus. So actually this past year, since I've been here, my wife and I, we go to UCLA probably about once a month on average to encourage those students that are there without a missionary or a campus minister. So we're there to encourage them and be a part of what God's doing there. But yeah, it's so strategic in these spring break trips, these summer mission trips we do. But also, as I think you're well aware, God is so strategic to bring the nations to us on the university campus. I was checking some statistics. UC Davis boasts that they welcome 7,500 students every year from international students from all over the world. And with that, it's 140 plus countries that they have checked off that they have had students come from. I was checking the UN list of nations. There's 195 countries that are listed in the UN. So practically the entire world is 30 minutes away over there at UC Davis. And you guys are helping us be a light for Jesus there. And we've had so many stories of international students coming to Christ. But this last fall was super special because we really felt like God gave us an opportunity to reach a community. We do a conversation hour every Monday at the community center, the ministry house there, where international students just come and practice conversational English as they're studying different programs at the university. And there was 8 Indonesian students that came out regularly to be a part of this community, and one of them was a believer. And if you guys don't know, Indonesia, 87% of that country is reported to be Muslim. It's really an Islamic nation. They say they have freedom of religion, but it's very difficult, and Christians are often very persecuted. It's very difficult for a worship gathering like this to happen in Indonesia. So this student who had faith in Jesus was so overwhelmed and encouraged that there was a campus community like ours that she could participate during her 10 weeks in the States, and she seized the moment. She was bringing her friends And we got to share the gospel with these Indonesian students. And Jennifer and I, we had them in our home the very last week before they went back. And we bought them in and out. We got some crumble cookie. And we just had just a blast, just loving on them. And they were literally weeping as we were saying goodbye. And we know that God's put a deposit in their heart. And that now in this student, we are connecting with a missionary out in Indonesia. So she's going to continue to be reaching her peers. And this was so encouraging. I have a friend that works in the international student department, and they do like speeches at the end of their 10 weeks on campus. And this student, the whole speech was about her experience with Davis Christian Fellowship. So hundreds of international students heard about what Jesus can do in a life. And really, friends, again, you are a part of this, and you're helping us be there to see stories like this happen. So let's just thank Jesus for that for a minute here. Yeah? Amen. So a couple of our students, they really have a burden for the Greek life on campus, you know, fraternities, sororities. If you go into Davis, Russell Boulevard, it's kind of known as Fraternity Row there. So on a Thursday, Friday, Saturday night, we're not necessarily a party school, but it is, it does happen. It is the university. And Samuel and Boaz, those are great names, biblical names there. They just had a burden to go out and just pray for students in the midst of the party scene. So they were walking the Russell Boulevard there, just praying, God, lead us to somebody who's open, who's ready, that we could potentially help them take that next step toward Jesus. And kind of their strategy really was just like to read a Bible verse to them. So they see a group of students and they approach them and say, hey, can we read a Bible verse to you? And these, you know, students, some of them are inebriated. They're just like, ah, sure, you know. And they just speak light. My mentor came to Christ on the college campus back in the Jesus movement in the 70s. And he said somebody did this in his life. And it was just like a pinprick of light into his dark thinking. Because the word of God is alive, right? And yeah, and sometimes, you know, we think we have to have all the right strategy and words, and I got to be able to articulate the gospel perfectly. But we can just trust Holy Spirit to do the work, because he's the one who's knocking on every human heart. So this is the strategy of these two guys. And one day they met another student named Reuben. I mean, this is these biblical names, I'm telling you. And we're not done, by the way. But Reuben, he heard that Bible verse, and he was super open. And he started opening up about some things going on in his family. He had a family member who was sick, and they prayed for him. And they were just so excited. Reuben said, hey, do you have a Bible? And they didn't have a Bible. They're using their phones. And they're like, no. And so anyway, they had left the meeting there, and they were just walking to the car going, why didn't we have a Bible? And they're just saying, God, can we just bump into Reuben again? Because they didn't get his number either. They were just kind of in this excited thing on a Friday night walking Fraternity Row. And so they prayed, said, God, can we see Reuben again? And they went to their car, got a Bible. And sure enough, you know, God answers prayers like that, right? They saw Reuben, gave him a Bible, got his number this time, invited him to our worship service, and Reuben gave his life to Jesus. And so it's amazing what God can do. I'll tell you one other story. And I'm telling you, I'm not making this up. So Samuel and Boaz, and you meet a guy named Reuben, they met a student named Hezekiah. I'm going to tell you. There's some church kids there at UC Davis, but Hezekiah did grow up in the church, and they called him Hezzy for short there. But it was the first week, you know, it's Hezekiah's freshman year, this last fall, first week on campus, and they bumped into him on campus and invited him to Davis Christian Fellowship, and he seems like, okay, maybe I'll check it out. And then they're on Fraternity Row, and they bump into Hezzy, and they see Hezekiah, and they're like, Hezzy, and he's not made good choices that night. And he just starts bragging about the choices he made too. He kind of forgot who Samuel and Boaz were. And so Samuel and Boaz said, hey, can we read you a scripture? He's like, oh yeah. And they read him 1 John 1:9. They said, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us from all unrighteousness. You guys won't believe what happened. Hezekiah heard the word of God. He fell to his knees and started weeping. And Samuel and Boaz were just, Carson was with them too that day. I got to get accurate on these stories. That's not a biblical name, but unless, no, it's not. Carson's not. But, and they helped him out. They got his bike home because he didn't want to get a BUI, because that happens, you know, in Davis. And they took him to church the next morning, and Hezekiah, you know, had an encounter with the Lord. I mean, God is knocking on every human heart. I really believe that. And it doesn't matter what choices we've made. He's chasing after us. And he's putting people in their path. And you're helping our community be there. So thank you, church. be praying for us. Picnic day, April 20th, is like the craziest day on campus. It just becomes like the city doubles in size, and students start drinking at like 9 in the morning. And it's like the Book of Acts, but it's not the Book of Acts. You know what I'm saying? They really are drunk. Okay. But we're doing a big pancake outreach, you know, hope to soak up some of the stuff there. But we're just going to love on students. And maybe if some of you want to come and help us flip some pancakes, you'd be welcome to join us and talk to Pastor Mike and Renee, and we'll coordinate that. But God is moving. We did a survey at the end of December, just this past fall quarter, just asking what God was doing in the students' hearts. We had 44 students say they made a new or renewed decision for Jesus. God is doing it. So there's 150 students regularly coming out for worship. And you don't think about this at UC Davis, but I'm telling you guys, God is at work. And he's healing hearts. We did a fall retreat. We do a retreat every term, fall, winter, spring. In our fall retreat, there was a student, Ramon, and he's a senior. You know, he's getting involved at the tail end of his college experience. But boy, he came in with some real heavy things. He had a broken relationship with his dad. His dad was an alcoholic and very distant from the family, really verbally abusive. And last spring, his dad died of COVID. And just terrible, terrible. So he's been carrying like this regret and that he never reconciled with his dad, and this anger toward his dad too, and just all this mixture of emotion. And we really talk about the father heart of God a lot in our community, the fact that God is a good father and that he's wanting to do what to make up the deficits in our life where maybe we've had from our own earthly fathers or mothers. And God was so faithful and really met Ramon at this retreat. And we walked through a prayers of forgiveness. And what Ramon was really motivated by is that he wanted to have a family one day, and he wants to be a good father, and he knew he couldn't do that based on the own modeling in his own life. So he is now encountering the love of the Father and uniting his life with Jesus, and his heart's being healed, and he has a vision for his life. Actually, I brag on my daughter Mercy because she was praying at our retreat during that time of prayer, and she's my 15-year-old. She's going to do her first driver's ed tomorrow. Pray for her. Pray for me. Getting behind the wheel. Oh, okay. But she was just praying a prayer, and Ramon saw Mercy pray and was just like, I want my kids to know God like that. And so it's just awesome what the Lord can do. It's really a generational thing that's happening as these students are setting a foundation of their lives on Jesus. So I just wanted to share a little bit of my story this morning. And I heard you guys are in a series just talking about the kingdom of God. And, you know, as a missionary, that's a little how God put this on my heart to be an ambassador of his kingdom. That's our theme that I want to go after this morning. But I was 14 years old on a missions trip to China, and I was with my youth group. We were smuggling Bibles into China. It was wild. And I heard this worship song by this worship artist, Bob Kilpatrick. You may know Bob Kilpatrick. I met him actually in person this past fall. But it's this song, "Here Am I, Send Me to the Nations as an ambassador for you." And I just remember as a 14-year-old, just my heart being stirred and saying, I want to go wherever you send me, God. Just I want to be an ambassador for you. And during my teenage years, I didn't really feel a call to a certain nation. And I just had this kind of desire to go to the secular university. All my friends who had similar inklings toward ministry were going to Bible college, which was wonderful. But I was like, I just feel like I'm supposed to go. And I came to UC Davis as a college freshman. And day one, I found this ministry, Chi Alpha. And lo and behold, Chi Alpha stands for the Greek letters taken from 2 Corinthians 5:20, which is this: we are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. And something clicked through my years as a student when I realized that parallel from that song. And God can speak in so many ways, right? But just the fact that he was calling me to be an ambassador at the university, and my love for the campus obviously grew as a student that I give the next two decades of my life to this work. But have you thought about this word ambassador? That's my question today. And what Paul is really getting at here. And to fully, I think, understand the passage, we have to look at a little bit of the context of what's happening here. As Paul is writing to the church in Corinth, he's really going after their identity of who they are. I mean, there was a lot of crazy things happening in the church in Corinth. You can look it up sometime, but there was people making some poor choices, we'll put it that way. But he says, this is not who you are. This is what Jesus has done in you, and this is who you're supposed to live. And listen to what he says. We'll start in verse 17 and read through verse 20.
says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he was committed to us the message of reconciliation. Here it is, verse 20. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. And wow, look at this verse, friends. We are new creations. The old has gone. I mean, even in that very moment of a student like Hezekiah repenting, he's a new creation. And he was aligning with what Jesus had done in him, even though he made that dumb choice that night. But, you know, the word reconciled, it's a fancy word to saying that we are back in right relationship with God. But this, the kicker in this verse is that the fact that as we've been given this right relationship, he has trusted us, given us the privilege. I love that, Pastor Mike, the privilege that we could be ministers of reconciliation, that we can tell others that they too can be in right relationship with God, that there's hope for them. And that we've given this title as an ambassador. You know, as a kid, even singing that song in that mission trip, you know, my thought of an ambassador is just like some guy, an old guy in a room sipping tea with some, you know, foreign leader, you know. But, you know, oftentimes these ambassadors, they're often the most risk of the enemies of the kingdoms that they represent. I mean, U.S. ambassadors, they go to some of the most dangerous and difficult places in the world. In their lives, their families, they are impacted by this chosen career. But they see tremendous value in what they do. I actually found a quote from a U.S. ambassador. This was back in the day. This ambassador, Prudence Bushnell. Now, that's a good ambassador name. Prudence Bushnell. See the T right there. Okay. But listen to what she says. She says, when you go out to the countryside, representing the most powerful country in the world, as the personal representative of the most powerful human being in the world, the president of the United States, and you meet someone who's different from you in every way, shape, and form, and you connect, it doesn't happen all the time, but when it does, it's just amazing. Now, Prudence, you can see in this quote, she's passionate about her job. She sees the value of connection with those who are different from her, building a trusted relationship. You know, ambassadors, they work closely with these foreign leaders and governments to secure these key alliances, these lasting relationships, and friendship is their goal. I got another quote. Ambassador to Japan, Howard Baker, he says this, I go out of my way as an ambassador, as the president's representative, as the presence of the U.S. in this country to make sure that the Japanese understand that not only are two countries allies, but we're friends. This is a U.S. ambassador saying this. So the key responsibility is relationships, maintaining that healthy relationship with the country they represent and building relationship with the foreign places where they live. Now, think of this in the kingdom of God. Now, Philippians 3:20 says this, says, but we are citizens of heaven as followers of Jesus, where the Lord Jesus Christ lives, and we are eagerly awaiting for him to return as our Savior. You know, in the book of Ephesians, I don't have the verse, but chapter 2, verse 6 says that we're seated with Christ in heavenly places. Like right now, even though we're living this life in the midst of the turmoil, that there's a perspective that he wants us to give, that as we declare today, he's above it all, and that we can have his perspective and partner with him as a citizen of heaven, that we know which kingdom we belong to, which kingdom that we represent in a broken world. This is a definition of an ambassador from the Oxford English Dictionary. It says this, an ambassador is a minister of the highest rank sent by the king of one kingdom to live as an alien in another and to speak what that king says while he is there. I think an ambassador is a perfect description for what Paul is describing as our role as a follower of Jesus, what we have access to because of our identity in Christ. We're not simply representing the most powerful man in the world, but the creator of the universe, the king that one day every knee will bow to. And we're sent as ministers of the highest rank, proclaiming the king's message of reconciliation. Now, I just want to speak truth over us today and over myself to know who we are, to know what authority we carry as followers of Jesus, that we can walk Fraternity Row and we can transform an atmosphere. These guys, even though they got biblical names, they got a little head start, but they can see the hand of God move through their lives, and you too can, in whatever difficult situation you find yourself in, as we lean into who we are in Christ. Yeah, he's entrusted us with this title. And really, to be a representative of him, our only way that we can do this well is if we stay connected with him, right? Just like the key responsibility of an ambassador is relationship, maintaining a healthy relationship with the country they represent and building that relationship with the places that they live. Our key responsibility is to maintain a relationship with the Father and to connect people with our loving Father. So really, my goal as a minister of the gospel, as a missionary to UC Davis, my goal is to first, I want to minister to the King first. Now, I want to be connected to the King before I try to represent him to others. And we can't speak the words that our King doesn't authorize. We need to know what's in his heart, know what's the things that he wants to say. We want to know his heart, his rules. And we need this by the word of God, right? We need to be just ones who read the Bible regularly, that we can know what his word says, what he wants to speak to the world around us. Know what his kingdom's like. Jesus over and over again in the gospel is just talking about the kingdom is like this. It's sometimes hard to fully, he's got all these analogies. But I love what Paul, how he describes the kingdom in Romans 14:17. I think we have the verse. It says, "For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit." This is the kingdom we represent. A kingdom of righteousness. There's a right way to live. There's a right way to do things. God has made us and wired us for a right way to live. There's joy. There's despite circumstances, despite what's happening around us, we can have just a knowing, again, there's a God who loves us. There's a hope for our lives that we are so much more than what's around us. There's an eternal kingdom that we represent. There's a joy and a peace that comes when we know this. And I think it's important to point out, too, that Paul says it's not a matter of eating and drinking. The context here, these Jewish believers in Christ now, they're carrying all these traditions, and they're thinking, okay, these Gentile, these non-Jewish believers, they have to now follow all these customs and rules. And Paul's like, no, it's not a matter of eating and drinking, but it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So we need to understand our manual, know God's heart for his people. So this is a question this morning. What are you communicating from our King as an ambassador to the people around you? I think of the passage again in 2 Corinthians 5 here, 5:19. God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. He wants this world to know that he loves them. Some people, when we talk about the love of God, they're just like, well, I'm not really into this God stuff. But my response to them is, oh, well, he's into you. and I just want the people to see the love of God through my love for them. And I can't control the outcomes, but I can do my best to keep my love on. And I pray that God would use you in the relationships he's trusted you with to reflect his love. Yeah, to connect people, to build trust, to show that there's a friendship that God wants to have with them. Yeah, I have a story. This is from early on in our ministry on the college campus. But I did an English conversation partner with a student from Japan. And he was just eager to, practice English. And we met weekly together. We got coffee. Sometimes we'd go on errands together, go to Walmart. But we just got to know each other. And I remember I took him to get like a winter coat because he didn't have a coat when he came to Japan. And I just, whatever way I could serve him, whatever way I could just show him kindness and love, I just went out of my way. I'm not tooting my own horn here, but it was just a genuine friendship. Even it was wild, like on the winter break, he wanted to go to Milwaukee of all places. I'm like, what? You're in the States here? You want to go to Milwaukee? I mean, Los Angeles or something? I mean, okay. But he wanted to go to he loved Harley Davidson, and I guess the original Harley Davidson plant is there. And some of these international students have some resources, so they can do stuff like this, But I helped him book a flight. I helped him, figure all that out. And he wanted to go to a Bucks game too. So he trusted me with his credit card, and we bought like a ticket there online. But it's just this true friendship developed, and got to be around Christmas time, and I just was trying to explain what Christmas means and tell the story of Jesus. And I had this idea. This is actually before The Chosen. I would totally use The Chosen now. But I grabbed the Jesus DVD, like the old one from like the 70s. I think it
But I remember there was a Japanese translation of it. So on my computer, we watched the Jesus film in Japanese. I didn't understand a word of it, but I know the story. Okay, so I had a little head start. But afterwards, I'm like, asking him, like, what do you think, like, about what Jesus did for us and what he came to do? And, there wasn't like that light bulb moment, but he was just kind of processing it. He was just, okay, yeah. And I was just so desperate. I wanted him to like start a relationship with God before he went back to Japan, and just praying for him and just believing. And it was the day before he was going to go back to Japan. And I was driving around. I think we were going to Walmart again or something. And I looked over and he was crying. And he's just like, Will, I've never experienced a friendship like this. And I just was like, oh, it's like, I've had friends who would go the extra mile for me. And I just said, Takayuki, that's the love of Jesus. My love for you is comes directly from him. And I was like, okay, is this the moment, right? And we went back to my house. We were planning to watch the U2 DVD, like a concert, because he loved U2. And there was a song by U2, Walk On. I don't even know that song. It goes like, walk on, you gotta leave it behind. I'm like, sign me up for the worship team next time I come, all right? No. But you guys are talented, by the way. What a gift that you guys have worship like this every week. Oh, my. But anyway, a light bulb in me went off. I'm like, that's the gospel. We walk on with Jesus and we leave the pain behind. We leave the sin. We're dead to sin. We're alive in Christ. And I just took that song and explained the gospel one more time to Taka, and he got it. And he's like, I want that, Will. And we prayed, and he began a relationship with Jesus right there. So praise God for that. I think it's a little simpler than we think what it means to be representatives of his kingdom. It's being a friend. It's loving people. It's going the extra mile. It's listening. Oh, boy. If as Christians if we can do better at listening, we are going to see a lot of people encounter the love of Jesus through us, especially in election year. I'll just put it that way. But will you be purposeful in representing the love of God as an ambassador? And there's three ways I think you can grow in this. Number one, again, know our King and his manual, the Word. Make a regular routine in your life to get into the Word of God. And number two, daily debrief with our King. We need debriefings, and that's prayer, where we can just open our heart to his, have a conversation, and listen for what he's speaking to you. And I tell students at UC Davis who are very cerebral, I mean, that's UC Davis, top five, public university in the nation, that sometimes, God will speak to us in ways that, using our imagination, you can't sometimes understand all these, okay, what was it? But follow those impressions of Holy Spirit, because God's a good father. He's speaking to you. And you need to have community to help you process what God is speaking to you too. And it's always got to align with his manual and the word of God, right? And number three, just communicate God's message of love through relationship. That's how we can be a better ambassador. Stay connected to our King with the word of God, daily debriefing. Just let it flow in friendship. So I just want to take a moment to pray for you. And I just Pastor Mike to come back up in a moment here. But would you just bow your head, take a moment of reflection? I'm just going to share a few things. I back in the day, I read the 2 Corinthians 5:20 verse, and I kind of did my own little message paraphrase. And I just came up with this, that God is not at war with you. God in Christ reconciled the world to himself. He's not holding your sins against you. I think the world out there feels like God is ready to smite them for every poor choice they're making, but I think as ambassadors, we got to come and say, God's not at war. He's made a way for peace. And maybe some of you today, this morning, just kind of feel a little stuck. Maybe that's a thought you've had. You've never really experienced God as a loving father. I just want today that you could know that peace, know the love that Jesus as the King of Love came to bring, and that you would experience his heart this morning, made a way for peace, that it was enough, the sacrifice that Jesus made to cover all the places where you've made poor choices. And so even right now, as I'm going to pray in a moment, just turn your heart to God. Just ask Jesus to reveal himself, to show you the Father, to take those places of brokenness and bring his healing. Do the great exchange that you would return. Repent means to turn, to change the way you think,
Maybe those addictions or places where they've just had a stronghold in your life, or you felt so gripped by them that you would just open your hand and just say, God, take it. Do the great exchange and let his kingdom come. Let his righteousness, the right way of living, his peace, his joy come and fill those places. Maybe some people here are challenged by this message of being an ambassador, and you know you've not been living like the minister of the highest rank. My call to you is just to tell your king you're sorry. He's a forgiving king. He's a gracious king, slow to anger, abounding in love, the psalmist says. And just do your best to listen next time. Do a little better. Maybe there was a prompting you felt from the Holy Spirit to talk to someone, but fear came in. And I just challenge you, don't live in regret and shame. Just do your best to do better and trust Holy Spirit to lead you. And then finally today, that there's others that are hearing this message and are challenged to be more purposeful in representing the kingdom. You know, there is embassies that God has placed in you, places of influence, your work, your home, you know, students on campus, their dorms, I mean, your work department. Maybe you frequent a Starbucks. That's your Starbucks. Maybe that's your embassy, a place where you can represent the king. My challenge is to just start praying and looking for ways to be answers to even your own prayers. We have a wonderful opportunity in the days we're living in. I know it feels like it's getting dark, but the light shines brighter in darkness. And as I always love to champion, the motto of UC Davis and UCLA and UC Berkeley, all the UCs, let there be light written on every one of their diplomas. So let's let the light of Jesus shine through our lives. Let me just say a word of prayer. Father, thank you that you see every human heart here, every human heart on this planet. God, you've created them in your image. You've given them purpose and a place of belonging. You've given them a home in you. And I just pray, God, that there would be a reconciliation that happens all around us as we are ministers of reconciliation, that we would take this message as we're your ambassadors, agents of your kingdom, and that we'd see lives transformed from the simplest of things, God, the ways we just show acts of kindness, the way that we speak truth and love, that we give an encouraging word, use it all for your glory, God. God, thank you, God, if you're reconciling hearts right now, even people doing that great exchange with you, they have a true vision of what kind of king you are. God, empower us all by your Spirit. We want to do better in the days we live in. We want to let your light shine. We trust you. We trust you, God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Come on, give him a hand. Stay right here. Hey, I wanted to pray for you. I know you're going to see your dad in a minute. And he said something about his dad. His dad doesn't currently know the Lord, but no foundation, but that's right. He's had addiction in his life. And right now he's in the hospital in Fairfield, diabetes. And you said, I'm praying he'll finish well. That's the promise of God. I really believe that's the prophetic promise of God for your dad. So I want to pray over that, but I want to pray over your ministry. Can we just stand to our feet and stretch our hands towards Will, their family in the back? If people will just surround the family in the back, just lay hands on them, Sandra. Lord, we thank you for your servant. We thank you that he is the mouthpiece of God, no doubt. Lord, he is a connector in the earth. And Lord, I pray that every person that comes in encounter with Jesus in his life would come to know you. And today would be the day of salvation in his father's life. Today would be the salvation, not tomorrow, not someday, but today, God, he would have an encounter with you. He would turn his heart back to you and he would finish well. Lord, that he would step into the inheritance that Jesus bought for him. I thank you, Lord, that Will still holds out the light. Lord, it's not been easy, but God says you've been faithful and I'll be faithful to my word for you. So God, we thank you for that. We bless this ministry, God. We're so privileged to be a part of it. And God, and what you're doing and building your kingdom in the lives of college students. And God, we step into the yes, a partnership of prayer, partnership to go, and partnership to give and invest our resources in this ministry. And we pray for those campuses that don't have this ministry yet. Lord, pour your Spirit out. Your word says that he gives seed to the sower, And so, God, I pray that the seed would come, the finances, the resources, but the right people for the right season would rise up and would step with boldness into those campuses, and we would see the salvation of the Lord, the righteousness of God, reign on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, that it would come to those places and lives would be changed, and God, we would see an outpouring across our college campuses. Lord, we decree it, we declare it, we prophesy it, we say, let it be so, God, in Jesus' name, because we're putting our trust in you. Amen? Come on, give them a hand this morning. Thank you. And if you said yes to Jesus today, maybe you're in the room, maybe you're watching online, and you said, you know what, I realize I've walked away from the Lord, but I came back to him today. Would you just let us know by writing a message right there, a comment, just say, I gave my heart to Jesus. I want to reach out to you this week. If you're in this room, we'll have prayer teams in just a minute. They're coming right now, and they're going to pray with you. They want to talk to you about the decision that you made. And maybe today God challenged your life. There's someone in your life that you know you need to be an ambassador. See, an ambassador, every place they stay up becomes the property of that kingdom. Our homes can be embassies for asylum to our neighbors. Come on, let's raise up some embassies for Jesus, some kingdom places that declare the light and the glory of God in the midst of darkness, that people can come running. They can come running to our door and knock and say, I need to know Jesus. So let's open God's heart. And I want to pray that prayer over you as we leave. Lord, I pray that we would be ambassadors. Our homes would be embassies of the kingdom of God. And Lord, there would be lights in our community that would dispel the darkness. Lord, there would be joy. There would be peace. Lord, there would be reconciliation and restoration because we hold the hope of glory within us. So today, God, we ask, what is in heaven be on earth in our life. And we declare this in the name of Jesus. And can we sing this song? Come on. I trust. Trust in you all week long. Let this be a theme of your life. I'm putting my trust in God, not in man, not in the stock market, not in an election. I'm putting my trust in the King of Glory. So today, if you're with us and you'd like to give, you'd like to contribute, we love a cheerful giver around here. We get excited about generosity. The links are going to be on the screen behind me, and you can just scan the QR code. Make sure to get that. If you want to know what's going on, follow us on Facebook, Instagram, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and you can also get weekly updates by joining our MailChimp newsletter. We send out I write a blog every week, and then we also have events that are coming up, things that you need to know about all-in membership. If you want to become part of the Real Life family, that's coming up next month. It's in that. So you need to be a part of that. Just ask one of our ushers or ask myself. We'll make sure to get you plugged into that. And then also our text alerts. So you get a text alert reminder of what's happening. Isn't that so convenient? So we're always glad to invite you because we want you to be a part of the family, the Real Life family. And we're glad you're here today. Would you do me a favor? Would you just turn to somebody, give them a big handshake, a hug, a fist bump, whatever you're comfortable with. We're so glad that you are here today. We are believing God.